California's gold is produced in association with KCET Los Angeles and is seen statewide on California Public Television. This series is endorsed by the California Teachers Association, the California School Boards Association, and the California Library Association. He was a Californian who lived a very interesting and a very complex life. Because, you see, not only was he an acclaimed attorney practicing law up in Ventura for 22 years, but was also an ardent sportsman and a constant world traveler. He spoke fluent Chinese and was a working rancher raising horses, dogs, and cattle. He was an enthusiastic wildlife photographer and had an in-depth knowledge of geology, archaeology, engineering, astronomy, natural history, and the breeding habits of the California gray whale. You getting the picture? This guy was a true Renaissance man. But of all the things he accomplished in his lifetime, he's probably best known for this one. He was the most famous fictional lawyer ever, known around the world through novels, radio programs, movies, and a very popular TV series. Perry Mason fought for the underdog and always won his case. And who created Perry Mason and wrote all 82 of those best-selling Perry Mason novels? Well, none other than our own California Renaissance man, Erle Stanley Gardner. Story goes, midlife, Earl got tired of being a lawyer and decided to start writing. And write he did, turning out over 127 novels, over 400 magazine articles, and countless other stories. But it's agreed by just about everybody that his favorite was writing those Perry Mason mysteries. And it's estimated that some 325 million of Gardner's books have been distributed globally, making him one of history's all-time best-selling mystery writers. And where did all this creative writing take place? Well, to answer that question, we traveled to the outskirts of Temecula in Riverside County to visit the beautiful oak-filled 1,000-acre ranch once owned by Erle Stanley Gardner. It's still mostly intact, and to visit this ranch is to go back in time, into a time warp, back to the days during the 40s and 50s and 60s that Erle Stanley Gardner was here. Well, we are standing here, Jeff, in front of the building where it all started. Tell us the significance of this little, simple little adobe building.
Well, this 10 by 20 adobe was the only building on the ranch when Uncle Earl bought it. And from this, he eventually developed this huge complex of over 20 buildings.
Now, let's get the facts down. He bought this in
1937.
And how many acres were involved in the process?
Eventually, he had 3,000 acres on his ranch.
Really?
Yes.
So it was a huge ranch.
Yes, it was.
And why did he choose Temecula? Why did he come here?
Well, he was on one of his little travel excursions out to the desert that he liked to take, and he stopped to let his dog Rex run around a bit, and the dog got all excited and started barking, and he got out to see what the commotion was and fell in love with the country. And then he started inquiring if there was anything available, and he found this ranch was available, and he bought it.
So wait a minute. He came here because his dog got out of the car and started barking?
That's right.
That's kind of a crazy way to choose where you're going to live, isn't it?
Well, he wouldn't have got out of the car and walked around if the dog hadn't started barking and having fun. And when he got out and started walking around, he realized what a beautiful place it was, and he decided he'd stay here.
Now, why did he want a ranch to start with?
Well, he didn't particularly want a ranch. He just wanted seclusion so he could think and meditate and write and enjoy the things he liked to do, horseback riding and archery shooting and bird study. And this just evolved over time. As the longer he stayed here, the more support he needed. So he had to build cabins for the help, place to stay for the guests, and the cook's house and the main lodge for entertaining, and just snowballed.
So he had quite a compound out here.
Yes, he did.
Now, when you talk about guests, who are we talking about? Who would have come out here and stayed in, I guess, one of these little guest cabins here?
Well, anybody who was anyone in publishing, a lot of authors. Raymond Chandler was one of his best friends. Heads of state, officials from Mexico, because he did a lot of trips into Mexico and wrote books on Mexican travel. So he had a lot of famous people.
So this was kind of like a poor man's Hearst Castle.
I suppose you
they
could
would
say
come out here and hunt and fish and just hang out on horseback. And
that's right, and just enjoy themselves. They could really get away from life, because in those early days, this was in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, I think you pointed out one of the buildings. I think it's right down here. Talk about getting away from it all. These were the outhouses here.
That's right.
They didn't even have electricity or indoor plumbing in the early days.
No, they didn't. In fact, the original two-holer is now my chicken coop. And power didn't come till 46, so for 9 years I had no electricity.
They were literally in the middle of nowhere out here.
They were.
All right, and this was ground zero right here. This was the main, what would you call it, a lodge?
This is the main lodge. This is where all the entertainment took place and where everybody was fed.
Ah, so they had to put on a big meal every night, too.
Every night.
Well, I guess you'd work up an appetite.
Oh, you would.
Going out and doing all of that outside activity.
All that horseback riding.
All right, let's go in the, this looks like the kitchen door back here.
This is the servant's entrance.
So we'll go in the kitchen through the back door. Okay, we are in the kitchen, and here to greet us are the Bossickers. And you all are here because you're supposed to be here.
That's right.
you have owned this place for how many years?
24 years.
So you've kind of gotten into the whole mystique of the Gardner Ranch.
Certainly.
I've taken a peek in here earlier. This is an amazing room. Tell us about this room.
Well, this is the lodge. The building is the lodge. And so basically this room was a dining hall for the complex. He was a great entertainer. I'm talking about Erle Stanley Gardner.
They would all Uncle Earl.
Here. Uncle Earl, that's right, Uncle Earl. They would all come here for breakfast, lunch, and supper, and had a good time too. And then the kitchen, the cooks cooked there, brought the food out here. They sat at the large table and around, and I think they did a lot of entertaining in this room too.
This is an amazing room, too, Jeff. This is all original.
Yes, and this is built by a Dutch shipwright who built wooden ships. That's why it has such a unique structure.
Wow, it's just beautiful.
Uncle Earl and Malone Vale would sit at this table and play cards and make bets on the horse races at Santa Anita, then listen to the results on the radio and see who won.
Now, this would have been where people would have come and just... What, they would have just sat around and enjoyed the...
Just sat around and enjoyed stories. I understand that Uncle Earl was a great storyteller. He would become very engrossed in his guests for 2 or 3 hours, and then all of a sudden disappear and do his writing.
This is where we eat, and this is kind of the central building. Come on down and I'll show you the study down here. This is where we do the writing. Come down out here. We have lots of view, fine elbow room. We have plenty of fresh air, very little smog, lots of opportunity to write, very little time. We, you can see here, there's 3,000 acres of office. I have about 10 buildings, different office buildings scattered around here. There's an Indian reservation over there, an Indian reservation on the other side, and there's a 96,000 acre cattle ranch over on the other side.
What a view he had looking out over these mountains.
Well, wasn't it fantastic? I can't imagine anyone not wanting to be here and just enjoy this.
You can see where he would get inspired.
Oh, definitely.
By the view. Now we're leaving the lodge and coming down to the place where the rubber hit the road. This is where the work got done.
This is what he referred to as his fiction factory. This was the office where the secretaries worked. He had 6 secretaries typing his manuscripts and doing all his correspondence. And he kept them busy.
So the secretaries, what did they just have, like 6 desks
six
there?
6 desks and telephones. IBM Selectric typewriters, state of the art.
And down here,
this was his study, and this is where he hung out.
The office building over here is where the girls do the writing, and when people come in, I sometimes tell them, well, that's where we write the stories, and then they go in and find six secretaries pounding away like mad. But then I tell them, here's where we think them up. And thinking them up is the hard part of it. This is the study in here where I think up the stories and where I dictate them. This is the inner sanctum, so to speak.
We're inside the office, and I've seen pictures. His desk would have been right
on this wall, well, right here.
Right here.
Right here.
And most of the pictures I've seen of him sitting at this desk, he was on a dictaphone.
Right.
Dictating to one of his six secretaries.
Well, actually, what he did is he drove 2 miles over on the other end of the ranch and stayed in this little Shangri-La cottage. And he would stay there for 3 to 4 days dictating a book into those cylinders for his dictaphone. And then when he finished, he'd drive back over here and give them to the secretaries. They would type it, give it to him in printed form, and he'd sit over here in the overstuffed chair under that light and blue line everything, making corrections and additions.
And here's the light.
And here's the light.
So he would, that's what this light was. He would sit under this light.
So it could be bright on his paperwork, and he'd blue line everything, make corrections, send it back to him, they'd type it up again, and he'd do this 3 or 4 times until he felt the manuscript was perfect, and then he'd send it to the publisher.
Wow.
And it's kind of interesting, when he was over in this little cabin all by himself, he'd drive over there in an old World War II Dodge ambulance, and if he needed any supplies or help, he'd run a white flag up a pole, and they could see it from the porch here, and they know to send somebody over there.
So this whole operation was kind of a, I don't want to say clandestine, but there was a lot of moving around. There were a lot of messages sent.
Oh. This is before cell phones. It's like the pigeons in the telegraph story. I mean, people don't believe me when I tell
them. What pigeons?
Well, they had a little pigeon house outside the lodge, and when a telegram came in Lake Elsinore, which is the closest telegraph office, they'd release a pigeon. And when it flew into the coop and rang the bell, then they knew to send a fresh pigeon and a driver to Elsinore to pick up the telegram.
Really? From one of his publishers?
From one of his publishers.
Ha! Now, this doesn't look this big.
No, it isn't. But we're just in one part of it.
Oh, okay.
We have to go through the hall here.
The secret door.
And you'll notice this modern light switch.
Now, what was in here?
He stored reference materials in here, so when he wrote his stories, he could be very accurate to case law, to forensics. And so he'd come in here and get a book and find what he wanted and go back and make corrections in his manuscript.
Now, what's behind this door? Because I have a feeling this just keeps on going.
It does. This is his dark room.
He was a photographer.
Oh, he was a great.
Are there lights in here?
There are lights in here. He was a. You'd say he was an amateur photographer, but because he had a lot of his pictures published in his travel books, I guess he was a professional photographer, but he loved to take pictures. He did a lot of black and white photography. And
here's
this is
his sink. He did his own photography.
He did his own. That's for the safe light. This is something that he loved to do as a hobby. And when he took his trips to Mexico and the American desert and wrote the books about that, he took all his own pictures. Some of those books are a little dated in time now, but they're very, very enjoyable reading.
So he wrote nonfiction as well, yes, travel books.
Yes, travel books. And you can tell he really enjoyed the desert, particularly in Baja.
All right, let's head through this door. Ha! Oh!
Now, this was his setting room, or living room, whatever you want to call it. This is where he could just come and relax by himself or with a friend.
So wait a minute, I thought he had a big living room up in the lodge.
Well, that was for entertaining with friends and acquaintances and family. He wanted to get away from that. He could leave them up there to party, and he could come down here and enjoy himself.
This was his thinking place.
Yes.
All right, so this was his little room here.
And this was his bedroom.
So he had a separate bedroom in here.
Yes.
Look at this. It was all made out of this wonderful old pine.
Right, old knotty pine.
This is just amazing.
And this is a full cedar-lined closet.
Oh, gosh.
This is wonderful. So he would spend a lot of time down here.
Yes. Unless now, he was out on the road on one of his trips, this is where he slept and this is where he stayed.
All right, coming out of the little study and looking around out here, Jeff, this was really a working ranch, wasn't it?
Well, it was. They were totally self-sufficient out here. They grew all their own food, their own livestock. And Uncle Earl's favorite fruit was a Bartlett pear. He had an orchard of 50 pear trees.
Really? Yeah. On the property?
On the property. There's still one alive today.
And these are historic things, well, too.
He loved the wildlife and this bird feeder and water. And then the little building down there is where he stored grain to feed the wild dove and quail.
Oh, boy.
And he'd sit out here and just throw feed, and they'd just come up. He just enjoyed nature.
So he loved nature. He was a photographer. He liked to travel to Mexico. He was an attorney. He was a writer. He was the Renaissance man.
Oh, he was. He was. And the proudest accomplishment that he had in his life, he said, was his court of last resort, which he developed to get people a new trial that felt they'd been falsely accused, and he was very successful in getting several people set free that had not committed the crime they were accused of.
So he, in real life, was a successful lawyer.
Yes.
Forget about all the Perry Mason stuff. On his own, he was a very successful and a very activist lawyer.
Yes, he was. And he used a lot of his fame and money to help other people in that regard.
Fame and money that emanated from the work he did
in the Fiction Factory.
In the Fiction Factory. And here we just happen to have with us today was a very integral part of that Fiction Factory. Introduce yourself to everybody. Oh. Betty.
Hello, I'm Betty Burke.
And your claim to fame, among many other things, was that?
Oh, I had 7 whole years with Mr. Gardner and typed everything that he that he spoke. Everything that he said was wonderful.
And this is where they had the secretaries all typing away in this building right
here.
They
were building this when I came to work for him in 63. And I had to learn how to use the equipment with the earphones and listen to what he was saying and type it with all this bang, bang, banging going on. I remember that.
How hard would he work the secretaries?
Well, we did everything that we could get done in a day, and they kept track of how many strokes we took, and honey kept a good record of how much work you put out in a day.
Really?
And accurately, of course.
Well,
yeah.
Was he a friendly man? Was he a good boss?
He came bumming over, and he'd come walking up this little path and then the stairs and look in, and one day he came in and he said, I don't know which one of you girls to give this to. This is kind of a naughty book. This is an AA Fair book. And I said, give it to me. I run a drugstore. I know all the words.
Well, it must have been exciting to type up. You were actually getting the first read on Perry Mason novel.
The only thing that frustrated me, I remember that first month, why I was working on the Amorous Ant. Case of the Amorous Ant, and we were winding it up. And boy, I couldn't wait to get to work that morning. And when I came in on my pullout, honey says to me, Betty, Earl just brought this in. That's what you're to do today. And it was an article for Sports Afield.
So he didn't finish the book with you?
No, but I got back to it again the next day. But he decided to do something else. And that was the first article that he wrote about how we should start protecting our forests, and when we go camping and when we go to the beach, that we shouldn't leave messes behind.
A good story, but not nearly as interesting as the end of that Perry Mason mystery novel.
And so that was very wonderful.
Was it exciting to work around here?
Well, of course, everything was interesting. There wasn't a dull moment.
Now, what do you mean by that?
Well, we didn't talk a lot or do a lot. We were working all day. We were typing.
What about the Perry Mason books themselves? Would he be frustrated if he couldn't come up with the... I mean, could you tell when he was in a creative mood?
No, because I think he did it all between 2 and 5 o'clock in the morning, probably.
What?
I think he worked through the night. I don't know.
Really? So when you would come to work in the morning, there would always be something new that he had done the night before.
At 9, he'd be walking along this path. There used to be a lot of bushes here, and he'd be walking along this path going up to breakfast at 9 o'clock. So that meant he had finished his dictating for the day. unless we got through, and then he could have a chance to dictate some letters, and then he'd say, tell Betty she can bring her pad and come over and I'll dictate to her, because he knew I loved to sit there with him and take his dictation. And he was a wonderful dictator because he watched your pen. He knew when you were relaxed and you were caught up, you know. So I learned to write a lot of shorthand.
You must have had, this must have been a wonderful experience.
I was in seventh heaven. He was marvelous person.
He was a good man.
Oh, so sweet. Never heard him grumble or complain or feel sick or anything. It was very, very wonderful.
Well, this has been a great day for reminiscing. Betty has been talking about her days as a secretary here. We've joined up with some other Uncle Earl experts from the local area here. Let's just talk a little bit about different aspects of his life. Sure. You mentioned to me something, the word podunk.
Used that term for kind of his camping expeditions, wherever he'd go, and he was going to stay somewhere for a while, well, we'll stay in podunk. And they just loved to travel and camp, and would be impromptu many times, just pick up and at the spur of the moment and go off into the country and explore.
Would he write when he was on these podunks?
Yes, he did. Inside his trailer, he had writing equipment. Often one or more of his secretaries went with him.
Did you ever go with him on any of these trips?
No married ladies went with him.
Oh! Well, who would go with him?
Well, I'll tell you, Jean usually went with him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she would actually take dictation and actually
work? On horseback, if necessary.
You're kidding.
Yeah.
Is that true?
That's what we hear.
So these were legendary podunk trips. And a podunk must have been what it was he was on when he discovered this place.
That's right.
Is that right?
That's right.
That's right.
And it's interesting, Sam, who's his right-hand man, he'd get a phone call, and Earl would say, Sam, we're going on a podunk tomorrow. Make it happen. And so Sam would have to scramble, get all the materials together. So in the morning when Earl got up to go, they were packed and ready to go.
Wow. So these were creative outlets for him.
Yeah, and he loved to write about traveling too, so a lot of the times his adventures led directly to his nonfiction writing, Baja California being one of his favorite places to go. You may have talked about that a little already, but he was an important explorer in that area and discovered some early cave dwellings and sites where early man had been that had long been forgotten.
Really?
So he would be considered a good amateur anthropologist, among other things.
Wow. And how did he become how did Perry Mason come about?
Well, he had been trying to write as a way to get out of the law office. He didn't like the routine of being 9 to 5 in the building and was looking for a way to support himself. And he tried writing. He tried several other forms of writing in addition to mystery writing. He wrote travelogues, he wrote other kinds of stories. So, but then he thought, well, I know about law, and I should be writing about that, and that's where I think the Perry Mason came in.
Because it's not easy to write a good mystery, is it?
No, I've written one, but it isn't that easy at all.
I mean, he must have had an innate knack for it.
Certainly more than any other mystery writer I can think of. He wrote, I believe, 82 Perry Mason novels alone in his lifetime. And remember, he didn't start when he was a teenager. He started writing somewhat later in life, as well as a number of other mysteries under the pen name A.A. Fair. And he never stopped writing magazine articles about the law, about fiction. It's a wonder the man ever slept.
Yeah.
He was astonishing.
It's amazing that I always felt that Perry Mason was his alter ego, and the twists and turns that he put into his books were right out of his early experiences in the law. One of the famous cases in Ventura was a young Chinese gentleman was accused of a crime, and the arrest warrant went to the wrong address, and Perry Mason happened to be the individual's lawyer, and so he had all the young men that fit the description come into court. He says, okay, which one did it? And of course, to the European mind, they all looked alike. Case dismissed. Mm-hmm. So he was very sharp.
Wow. So he probably really did draw from his days as a lawyer in Ventura.
Oh, I think that's for sure. And you know, he was not only just creative, but he was very accurate, too. So his experiences in different aspects of criminology contributed to the kind of authenticity of his writings, which made him, you know, as famous as he was.
Well, it all happened right here, right down in that little house right there. How many of the Perry Mason novels do you think were written right here on this spot?
Of the 82 that he wrote, I would say about 60 to 65 were written in that building.
Right here, and you typed a lot of them.
Yeah. I typed 23 of them. Yeah.
And today they are part of the American literary heritage.
Very much so.
And it all took place right here. And the name of this place again?
Rancho del Paisano.
Rancho
del Paisano.
And what does that mean?
Ranch of the Friends.
Ranch of the Friends. What a wonderful name. And what a fine example of California's gold.
While on a trip, George had met Helen Baird, a young divorcee. A casual acquaintance had ripened into an intimacy, and almost before George knew it, he was leading a double life. By telling his wife that airplane travel made him uncomfortable, George was able to take the train at Riverside, disembark a few minutes later at San Bernardino, then take a train to Oceanside via Los Angeles. In Oceanside, Helen Baird had a cute beach cottage, and to the neighbors, George Arvell was known as George Baird, Helen's husband, a traveling executive. Because George was supposed to be traveling on a train to the eastern oil fields, he could spend a day or two with Helen at the beach, and then Helen would drive him to San Diego. From there, he would catch a night plane to his destination, from which he would call Selma.
Well, hello, everybody. I'm Huell Hauser, and I sure hope you enjoyed this adventure. If you'd like to see it again or share it with your family or friends, or perhaps donate a copy to your local school or library, it's available on video cassette and on DVD. All you have to do is call 1-800-266-5727, and we'll be glad to send it to you right away.